My book, COVID-19 Decoding Data, had just been released in English. I had the honor of being introduced by Dr. Sam Bailey, who has done a tremendous job over the past few years to help us navigate through this crisis. My book is a bestseller in France with over 50,000 readers. As a statistician, I expose the complete fraud of COVID-19 using official and public data. Everything is right before our eyes if we choose to open them. In the coming weeks, I will be offering a series of videos in English to explore the work I have conducted over the past 4 years. Virus or no virus? The debate continues to understand the origin of the paranoid delusion called COVID-19. My training, or my bias, led me to study this concept extensively from a statistical perspective. The conclusion of 4 years of work is quite clear. There is no trace of any new pathogen in the statistics of illnesses or deaths in the recent years. All excess deaths are due to the mistreatment of the most vulnerable out of fear of the virus. All dates and numbers align with this explanation. This approach can be called bottom-up, starting from the final statistics and working back to the foundations, concluding that nothing labeled as COVID-19 is scientific or even coherent. Some proponents of the top-down methods also criticize the lack of certainty or even science in the theory of the new asymptomatic coronavirus, SARS-CoV-2. Others, on the contrary, believe its existence is well proven and its properties known. To support their claims, they often cite scientific articles published in major journals, while noting that these are unreliable when results are unfavorable. In a discussion on this topic, Yves Razier sent me a study published in the prestigious journal Nature proving that SARS-CoV-2 is indeed a pathogen. The study looks at the genetic resistance of a large number of mice that researchers supposedly infected with the virus. Reading this article and trying to verify the announced result with the data provided in the appendix, I was so astonished by the inconsistencies in every aspect that I called my friend Eusebe Brioche for help. I reached a point where I preferred he show me that I could no longer do simple addition. Unfortunately, the reality is worse than expected, with Eusebe further criticizing this prose written in globish, masquerading as science. I will probably end up needing therapy as merely seeing someone in a white coat on a screen now triggers uncontrollable laughter. From the first reading of this paper, we discovered that there is no control group in the sample. This seems to be a common practice in virology, but it surprises us every time. In a study claiming to show that mice are infected by SARS-CoV-2, one would expect a group of mice subjective to the same conditions, isolating them in cages, anesthetizing them, filing their bronchi, but without infecting them with a pathogen. This is a principle of scientific proof. We must isolate the study object if we want to prove its properties. Well, it's worth noting that isolate is one of the words that easily angers virologists. Here we must simply believe that it is the virus making the mice sick since we have no virus-free mice. Speaking of the virus, where did our lab find one? To infect a mouse, one must have a sample of SARS-CoV-2 to give it. Possessing an object over which there is still a scientific debate about its actual existence closes the debate in an unexpected way. Mark Bellay's book, A Farewell to Virology, reminds us that no virus has ever been isolated for proper study, let alone transmitted. The original sequence of SARS-CoV-2 published in early 2020 by a Chinese lab has never been reviewed anywhere. In early 2022, a mathematician working with Dr. Stefan Lanka attempted to retrieve this sequence from the Chinese lab's results and their software, but never succeeded. This raises the question of simple fraud with a sequence purely invented for the occasion. when at the end of March 2020, the UHI of Marseille declared it had found its first variant, their reconstructed sequence matched only 86% of the initial one. An 86% match is the genetic correspondence rate between a human and a mouse. For virologists, we are essentially the same. This dismisses the problem of claiming to deduce something about us from experiments on these small animals. The scientists behind this paper claim to have obtained the virus from the medical branch of the University of Texas. It sounds serious. So we must take their word for it since no verification is done on this achievement.
Indeed, they bought vero cells cultivated alongside a classified ENCOV WA1 2020 MN985325.1 by a sequencing that has undoubtedly never been reproduced a second time. These are PSH4 vero cells, meaning they have undergone the treatment they usually receive for a culture four times in a row with antibiotics, disinfectants, or serum and co. Finally, the mush is cryopreserved with dimethyl sulfoxide, a conservation agent almost systematically used for this purpose. When we say it probably has never been reproduced a second time, it is no exaggeration. In its explanatory video on the isolation of SARS-CoV-2, which is not isolation in the proper sense, of course, the UHI of Marseille explains that it has more than 7,000 strains of the virus. In other words, we almost never find the same thing twice. Rather than concluding that the pathogenic virus theory is false, we prefer to conclude that the virus mutates all the time. So, we have our virus mutation. But the mice we are going to infect with the virus to make them sick with COVID are not left out. The mice are sick by design, all mutants and inbred. One could say this simulates the comorbidities of COVID patients, but honestly, considering where these poor creatures come from, it's surprising they don't die in the postal package. As for the expected COVID symptoms, as usual, it's a catch-all for anything unpleasant that can happen to mice. Only cheese indigestion wasn't included in the list. As with humans, there is no scientific definition of COVID. From there, we can interpret the health status of our mice any way we want to put them in the COVID category. First, they must be infected with the mush ordered from the University of Texas. The mush is sowed, then recultivated with the usual soup. Then we inject 50 UL in the noses of anesthetizing mice for the occasion. Imagine the cup of crap in the lungs. By relative weight, 50 UL for a mouse is 10 centiliters for a human, equivalent to a balloon glass of toxic junk injected into the respiratory tract. Lung and brain damage guaranteed. Yes, let's not forget that in these creatures, the sieve plate separating the nasal septum from the brain is very porous and it is very extensive. Experimenters all assume dimethyl sulfoxide is only toxic at high doses, hence their care in raising various cells. But we recently realized that DMSO is neurotoxic even at very low doses. Oops. Isoflurane, used to put the mice to sleep, is known to cause respiratory mucosal inflammation, guaranteed coughing for the poor mouse. In others, as if that wasn't enough, they also injected vero soup in the peritoneum a day earlier. The mice were then kept in lovely individual cells, which undoubtedly greatly pleased these social little rodents. Nothing like a little depression to wait for death without regret. We recall here the absence of a control experiment. One should take mice, anesthetize them, inject them with all the experiment's products, except the virus, obviously, into their bronchi and isolate them to see their health condition. Obviously, the risk is proving that all conclusions are false. When you've paid to get published in the prestigious Nature, that would be unfortunate. Obviously, as a statistician, I was driven by a bad reflex: to download the study data and recalculate. Apparently, I've failed to adapt to 21st century science. The study is supposed to prove things about the survival and weight loss of virus-infected mice based on their genetic background. No data on the mice's weight or survival is provided. That's quite unusual. But the data is also extremely strange. There are numbered mice, but there are no consecutive.
Mice number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8, 11. Where are mice 7 and 9?
Numbering allows tracking individuals in an experiment. It is an important marker to show proper population tracking. It's even mandatory good practice in clinical trials. The disappearance of subjects with inconvenient results is one of the frauds in Pfizer's anti-COVID vaccine study, as revealed by OpenVet. We are thus suspicious since there are only 240 mice in the file for 305 numbers, a 20% loss. But more, when we try to total by mouse type, we do not match the study's graphs. Where did these results come from and how could they have been peer-reviewed? Worse, the file only tells us if the mouse has lung disease and its severity. From least to most severe, we have known, 39 mice, minimal, 87 mice, mild, 77 mice, and moderate, 34 mice. How can researchers tell us there is a massacre among the mice when they are barely sick? What are they dying from? In some studies, researchers kill animals at the slightest clinical sign to conduct their analyses. Then they announce near zero survival rates, blaming the nasty virus for causing havoc. I asked my friend Ozeb for other explanation. He told me that 25% of the mice are not sick or do not have any virus detected. Yet, they still die like the others. The researchers merely count what they intended to count. A given strain has a certain proportion of antibodies with a certain proportion of variants, etc., etc. They cannot be wrong. They measure what they measure. If the figure is low, they say the strain is resistant. If not, they say it is fragile. To quantify the amount of virus, they use the plaque assay method. They recultivate viral cells with samples taken from the cadavers of the mice, presumably killed for this purpose, whether they were sick or not. Let the viral cells live their best lives in a petri dish, and then coon the holes left by the viral cells that died from boredom. I won't even go to the serologies, PCR and sequencing, all exclusively conducted to detect SARS-CoV-2. Above all, they detect nothing else. And the best way to find nothing else is to look for nothing else. Believe me if you will, but it works remarkably well. The peer review reports are amusing. Reviewer 1 tells us, minor points. In accordance with the journal guidelines, the authors should avoid data not shown statements and instead include data necessary to evaluate the claims of the paper as supplementary information. No. Hiding data is not a minor point. The authors eventually replace the hidden data with outrageously positive data. It was worth hiding them. The second writes, a major concern is a lack of power in some of the observed results. PFU values in several tissues, pneumonia score, mainly because in each mouse strain studied there are mice that behave differently and this complicates the interpretations of the results. This is indeed a major concern. The others seemingly did nothing to address it. One senses a sort of collusion between the others and the reviewers. You don't want to upset the future reviewers or former authors in case of the former reviewers or future authors wish to enrich their CVs. In summary, we have a bogus study that hides its data to announce exceptional results aimed at improving knowledge in genetics. They took mice, injected them with junk in their lungs without a control group to claim that it's the virus that causes COVID. Clearly, it doesn't work. The mice didn't even have lung infections. The researchers probably killed them anyway for analysis, thus achieving a nice mortality rate. It's so ridiculous at this point that one wonders if it's a prank. What can be deduced from such a mess? Especially concerning humans. Finally, this crisis has led me to understand that for the researchers involved in this scam, there is as much relationship between two alleged COVID variants as between a human in a mouse. Experiments on mice make sense since they are just variants of humans. Perhaps the best part, last May the 1st, the same journal Nature published an article announcing that a team of researchers tried to give COVID-19 to 35 human volunteers using SARS-CoV-2 and failed. They tried increasing the virus doses with each attempt and gave up at 10,000 times the dose supposed to cause illness. All that for this. 4 years of madness fighting against something that no one can properly isolate and that no one ever tried to see if it actually causes illness. Let's remember that in 1919, Milton Rosenau's team tried to make healthy people sick with the Spanish flu to understand how viruses spread. It was complete failure. The book, Can You Catch a Cold, delves in this subject. Teaser alert, it will be the next book I share with you. In the end, I don't know what's crazier. Realizing the complete lack of scientific justification for the paranoid delusion of COVID-19, or seeing that some people are still clinging to it.